Hi, I'm John F. Allen.
And I'm R.J. Sullivan.
And we're the Two Towers.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Two Towers Talk Show. I'm your host, Tower 1, John F. Allen.
And I'm Tower 2, R.J. Sullivan.
Today we have a very special show because we have a very special guest. R.J.?
Well, I'm pleased to announce that we have one of my favorite writers. Growing up as a Star Trek fan and following the Next Generation, hers was a name that I noticed early and often as someone who produced high-quality episodes for the show and was part of the staff, and was kind of following her career there for a while. She dropped away for a few years. We'll let her talk about that, and now she's back, and she has a lot of new projects going on. And she's also very personable and approachable on social media, which is a lot of what has made this possible. But I'm looking forward to talking to Miss Melinda Snodgrass, one-time script editor of The Next Generation and science fiction writer, and lots of other things going on. We're going to be getting into that today. Hi, Melinda.
Hi, RJ. Hi, guys. Thanks for inviting me.
Really thrilled to have you here.
Absolutely.
So, I think a lot of people are probably best know you for your connection to The Next Generation and Star Trek in general. So, I'm going to just jump right into that topic at first, if that's okay with you.
Sure, that's fine.
When I was in college and high school, I was reading the pocketbook paperbacks of the Star Trek novels pretty much as they came out. I remember going through them one by one, and I'm holding The Tears of the Singers in my hand, which is marked as number 19 of the series. And that most likely means I'd read the other 18 and came away thinking that they were pretty good to somewhat not so good to anywhere in between. But I remember when this book came out that it was quite exceptional from the rest. It really captured a tone and a feeling for the original series that really hadn't quite been done the same way since. So first I wanted to tell you that, and that the title and your name caught my eye right off the bat. So when your name showed up on The Next Generation, it didn't take me long to figure out the connection. I had heard, as you know, there was plenty of Star Trek fiction out there everywhere and behind the scenes magazines about The Next Generation as it was out. Someone told me somewhere that this book was why Gene Roddenberry went looking for you or recruited you. Is there any truth to that whatsoever?
Absolutely none. No truth.
No truth to that.
That is an apocryphal tale.
Have you heard that before?
Actually not true. They actually never knew I'd written books.
Oh, is that right?
I've been working on the show for almost 6 months when one of our assistants had some of my other novels that I had been writing on his desk for me to autograph, and my boss, Morris Hurley, walked by and said, "Did you write these?" And I went, "Yeah." And he went, "Oh, that's awesome." So no, they didn't actually know. I came to Trek because of a little-known writer. He had high hopes he'll be successful, but a guy named George R. R. Martin.
Yeah, we'll be talking about him later, I know.
Yeah, but actually it's George who got me, his request or his offer that I write a script on spec that he would show to his agent was how I ended up getting a job on Star Trek.
Okay.
Would you like me to go into that?
Go into that, by all means.
Okay, so George and I had become very close friends because he lives in New Mexico, as do I. And George had gone off to Hollywood to work first on the new Twilight Zone and then on Beauty and the Beast. And he called me one day and he said, "Hey, Snod, I think your strengths as a writer, which is, you know, really strong characters and great dialogue and you plot really, really well, would be very useful in Hollywood. I think you'd be really good at this writing for Hollywood thing. And if you want to try, if you'll write a spec script, I'll show it to my agent." And I said, okay, that sounds like fun. Sure, why not? I quit my law practice. I was writing novels, you know, and they don't pay all that well, so what the heck? And I looked around at TV shows to try to write my spec for, and I thought about L.A. Law because I was an attorney, but it looked too tightly plotted. Right. And I didn't want to write for Beauty and the Beast because I thought if I wrote a really crappy script, then it put George on the spot, either to tell me it was crappy or to show his bosses and have them say, why did you show us this crappy script? And I had grown up as a little kid on Original Trek, and I loved it. Kirk and Spock and McCoy and the Enterprise, I mean, it was like my fantasy made real because I had been reading science fiction from the moment I could learn how to read.
Awesome.
So I wrote a spec Star Trek and called The Measure of a Man.
Uh-huh. And I know where that goes. Go on.
George said to me, you know, you never, ever, ever sell your spec script. Nobody sells their spec script. And he said, what you want to do is write a script, and then if they like that script, they'll have you in for a pitch session. So you should come up with 3 to 5 other ideas. So I called George, and this is actually the single best piece of writing advice I ever got from anybody. I called George, and I said, look, I've got this idea for a script based on the Dred Scott decision, which was an infamous Supreme Court decision. Mm-hmm. And I said, but it's so good that I kind of hate to waste it on a spec that won't sell. So maybe I should write something else and save it for the pitch if I get a pitch. And George said to me, Melinda, never hoard your silver bullet.
Mm.
Always lead with the best thing. What you meant was, you know, always lead with the best thing you've got. And right. I think that's the greatest advice I can give to any aspiring young writer, actor, singer, whatever it is. Always do that thing that you're most passionate about that is the best idea you've ever had. Because not only did I sell my spec script, which George said would never happen, because of my ability to take notes and work well with the people, they hired me on the show.
There you go.
So that's how it all happened. So no, Gene had never heard of me.
Well, I wish I could remember where I read that, but you know, there were so many magazines with so many different sources that were all over the place at the time. And I read it, and it sounded believable. I was like, well, that makes sense. That was a good book. That would explain. But, you know, without getting too far into it, there were a lot of legend has it type stories about Trek back then that, you know, have since been either disproven or questioned or that sort of thing. So, another thing about The Next Generation that I'd like to talk to you perhaps a bit more is the perception, as a fan, I remember the first episode came out when I was in college, and we were excited to watch it come out week by week, and all the buzz was that this is, you know, $1 million per episode, high budget, first rate everything, they've really thrown everything at this to make it the biggest success possible. And then I'm watching Netflix about 3 weeks ago or so, and I caught this special called Chaos on the Bridge, which a documentary that kind of goes behind the scenes of those first 3 years, I think, is what it covers.
Right.
It tells a very different story.
it was my first foray into television, and it almost ended up being my last, because it was so... It was a very difficult show, and I didn't realize how difficult until I went on to work on a well-run show called Reasonable Doubts, and then I went on to be a co-executive producer on Profiler and do other things. I mean, it was in fact a chaotic show. The money was spent. There were certainly talented actors, but it was a very, very difficult experience. They went through, in the 7 years of the run, they went through more writers than any show has ever gone through. It was pretty astounding. It was just, there were mixed signals. There were too many chefs, and Gene had become a man who was trying desperately to protect his legacy. And when you're writing for legacy, I think it becomes a lot harder to write something that's entertaining and dramatic and interesting.
Yeah, yeah. I will say that as the show went along, it seemed like the third season seemed to be about where it found its tone and voice a bit more. The first couple seasons were pretty rough, although it got better as it went along, and I think in no small part to the fact that that was where most of your scripts were being produced as well. I think...
Thank you. I mean, we had a good... I mean, I had there were good writers with me. Ricky and Hans were a lovely writing team. And then, of course, eventually we hired Ira Baer as a co-exec producer. And Ira is just a lovely human being, a fabulous writer. He's on Outlander now. And I think he really helped kind of protect us, the junior writers, from the upper echelon of the powers that be. And we actually managed to sneak through some things that had some heart, had some emotion, and had some drama. I was hired after this writer's strike of '88 ended, and I was hired, so I was on the show for half of the second season and all of the third season. But the show burnt me out so badly that I said I didn't want to come back. And in fact, I wasn't even going to come back and work in television. I was going to come back to New Mexico and write books, because I was like, if this is what television is like, I don't want any part of it.
Yeah.
But fortunately, I got hired on Reasonable Doubts and found out what a well-run show looks like. So,
And then you were on TV. I'm sorry, go ahead.
How much fun it can be on a show.
Yeah, one of the things about that special, I think it's still available to rent on Netflix, and if you guys have any interest in this topic whatsoever, it is well worth the hour it takes to watch. Very interesting. Kind of odd because it's a William Shatner production, and he's the one hosting it and all that, and so it has sort of outsider kind of exploring things after the fact. But it was neat for me because I got to see what a lot of names on the screen looked like and learn some things about their personality, because Ira Baer is a name until I saw him in person for the first time on the Netflix special, and it helped connect the personality and everything else. That was kind of neat as a fan to see that sort of thing, and I can see how he would be, he seemed like, he was one of the person who presents himself pretty well on that show. I can't say that of everybody on it, so.
Well, it was a mix, and what I can say is, that was my first opportunity to meet Bill Shatner, and Bill is the best interviewer I've ever worked with. He's amazing. I said to him after we finished, I said, you should be doing the presidential debates, because he's really tough. He drives in with follow-up questions that are not softballs, you know. He really, you know, makes you think about things. He's a terrific interviewer.
Interesting.
We also share this. We both adore horses. So after we filmed my segment, he invited me to stay for lunch, and then we talked about our horses for the entire time, because we're both horse people. He's a lovely person. So that was an experience for me as a Trek fan. I mean, what a thrill. I got to spend an afternoon with Captain Kirk.
That would be a blast, yeah. And reports on him are mixed, you know that. Some people say he's an absolutely lovely person, and other people have some less kind things to say, and that could come from a number of places. But that's cool that you had such a positive experience meeting one of your heroes.
The man he was as a young man when he was a star, you know, people mellow. I mean, he's 80, I think, now. So,
there you go.
He's still writing, so he's really amazing. He'd asked me one thing. There was something I said that unfortunately didn't make it into the documentary, but he and his producer were sort of fascinated with it, because at one point during my interview I said, I felt like I was in a production of King Lear, and that Gene was Lear. And,
yeah.
There were, you know, there were just these Goneril and I forgot the other sister's name. That there were just these forces around him, because he was a fairly damaged, shattered individual. You know, still a mighty presence, but there was almost tragic quality to what was going on.
Yeah.
And when I said that, he said, "Oh, we're definitely using that." And then it never made it into the cut. So, but I did want to throw that out there. That really was, because Gene was a large man. He was like 6'6".
Uh-huh.
And so there was a sort of towering presence, but then with all of these attendant problems.
Not all that different, but it reminded me of Lord of the Rings, the king who has the guy whispering in his ear, and he's just kind of completely out of it and taking terrible advice all the time.
It truly was. Gene had worm tongues all around him, no doubt.
And that's unfortunate and sad. I mean, I was an admirer of him growing up, and it's sad to hear how that all turned out. But ultimately, his legacy has certainly continued and is certainly highly thought of. So I guess it wasn't all bad.
No, I mean, there are only a handful of men who truly changed culture. I mean, there's Gene Roddenberry, there's George Lucas, and
right.
There's Walter, and then there's Disney, Walt Disney.
There you go. One more question about Trek, and then I think we'll probably want to shift gears, but I'm curious, in your role as script editor, if you look back and recall some wonderful ideas that crossed your desk or maybe you came up with that you really wanted to see get into the show that just somehow didn't make it or got vetoed or anything like that, if there's anything you'd like to discuss.
Oh God, there were lots of them. I mean, and actually the title is Story Editor.
Story Editor, my apologize.
It's Staff Writer, Story Editor, co-producer, and then there's all these weird titles. But so story editor is like the second rung up from the lowest of the low.
Oh dear. Okay.
As George says in Hollywood, if you have a writer in your title, it means you're like a crawling worm on the face of the earth.
Oh,
if you're you never have the title writer anywhere in your mentioned. So that's just kind of a small irony. No, I mean, there were a number of stories that would float past and we would come up with and would get shot down because they were considered. I mean, the boys and Ira and I desperately wanted to go back and do a return to a piece of the action.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we proposed it because we were all grew up on Trek, and they just shot that down. I mean, Rick Berman was a man without a sense of humor, let me promise you. we were left with these kind of, and what they loved was technobabble, you know, lots of technobabble. And the more emotional the story was, the more uncomfortable they became with it. It was funny. It was deeply emotional. Those things were never going to fly. I mean, they just weren't going to go past. I mean, I sort of became the Data expert because I like to write for Data because he was the most interesting character.
Right.
Which I think is actually one of the flaws of the show, because when your robot is more interesting than your people, I think you have a problem.
And he was the first character to get like a huge fan base too. I mean, everybody had opinions about various members of the crew, but everyone pretty much agreed they liked Data pretty well. So.
Well, yeah, because, you know, he wasn't perfect. I mean, Gene literally said to us one day at a meeting, my people are perfect, they have no flaws. Well, I don't know how to write about perfect people. That's boring. And, I mean, the reason we love fiction, stories, narrative, is because it illuminates the human condition. It tells us, you know, how people hurt, or it helps us understand how to be heroic. If you don't do that, if your people are just heroic and perfect, then there's no sense of a journey. There's no sense of discovery of the human heart. And that was what was so desperately lacking in Trek. And certainly, I mean, I wouldn't know after I left because I've never watched another episode of any of the shows. That's how burned out I was.
Wow. See, I heard you say that, and I wanted to confirm that. You stopped watching at the end of season 3? You've never seen an episode after?
Okay,
I'm going to make a...
don't ask me any questions about Deep Space Nine or Voyager or even later seasons of Next Gen. I don't know.
I am going to recommend an episode to you, though, because I heard you say something in another interview about... Well, why don't you tell the people your view of the holodeck and how it would ideally be used if most people were using it for its true purpose? You want to talk about that?
Well, I mean, you know, I think there's only two things you would actually use a holodeck for. One is porn, clearly. And the other would be if you had a doctor, a psychologist, you would use it for psychiatric treatments. But otherwise, I hated the holodeck.
Right.
I made the mistake of once again saying in a meeting with Gene present that could we discover the holodeck caused cancer and could we kill it? It made for lazy writing.
Yeah.
And dumb stories. And what I didn't know is Gene had created the holodeck, and so he was not happy with me.
Right.
I hated it. I just thought it was a terrible thing. I mean, because those people go in there and they play with themselves, and there was no interaction. And if you look back on original Trek, some of the most memorable moments that you remember is people in the rec room with Uhura singing and Spock playing the harp, or playing chess, and this sense of people doing things together.
Right.
And the holodeck was the antithesis of that.
It could be. Yeah, I mean, I'm not gonna say I hated the holodeck. I think there were some good uses in certain episodes, but especially early on, it seemed like they didn't quite have a sense of how they could best make use of it. But there's an episode, I think it's fourth or fifth season Next Gen, called Hollow Pursuits. It's one of those with Dwight Schultz, in which it's actually kind of put to use the way you talk about. And the funny thing about it is that his character is kind of treated as the oddball, like, nobody would use a holodeck for this, that's so strange that he's doing, you know, he has these fantasies about Deanna Troi, and he has other members of the crew are either portrayed.
I'm familiar with that character and that script, because the first iteration, that character appeared for the first time while I was still on the show in the third season. It was a spec script that came in. Not a spec script, I don't remember how it came in, but anyway, it came in, and, you know, I thought the idea of a guy who has a hollow addiction was a good idea, because I thought it was dreadful. I mean, and also, every time you turned around, the damn thing was breaking and taking over the ship. I mean, that would happen once, and the Federation would go, okay, we're getting rid of those things.
Well, yeah, and of course, there was the other problem with Wesley always rescuing everybody out of everything, and that was something they eventually had to address over time, too. They tend to kind of rely on those same fallbacks. Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
like,
people are perfect and they have no flaws, so coming up with a story was sometimes, well, how about they get trapped in something?
Okay. Right.
Well, I think I'd like to interject here in regards to the holodeck. I actually like the holodeck as a viewer, probably because it reminded me of the Danger Room from the X-Men comics, which... I was surprised that Trek writers did not use the holodeck as a training environment for, you know, the Federation officers, since they're going on all these missions and it seemed to be a bolder interaction with different alien species than in the Next Generation than it was a lot of times in the original series. But it's interesting that you had mentioned about using the holodeck for porn. I know you haven't, you said you haven't seen Deep Space Nine, but just to tell you, in Deep Space Nine, there was a bar owner named Quark who was a Ferengi, and he had a bar, and he had holo suites, and the holo suites could be rented out by anyone who was coming there for carnal pleasures of the sort, and it's interesting that eventually somebody picked up on that for a different series and used that technology in the way that you had mentioned. I found that to be a little funny when I heard you say that. That's why I kind of chuckled when you said that. So somebody got that idea.
If you actually did a story about two real people who meet and interact, as opposed to, you know, some guy and his fantasy hottie, I mean,
yep.
I just, you know, it's like it's the antithesis of drama or storytelling, unless you make it about psychological issues that have people addicted to it.
I think we've talked quite a bit about Trek. Do you have anything you want to ask regarding Star Trek?
Well, since we're on the holodeck, would you like to hear George Martin's and my theory about how Next Generation should have ended?
I'm always interested to hear things about George Martin. Go ahead.
So George and I were talking, and the show had ended, and neither one of us seen it, you know. I gather it did end with a poker game, which I invented the poker game for Measure of a Man.
Okay.
But anyway, yeah, everyone can thank me for the poker game, because that was how I had Data doing something else he was trying to learn to do, and they couldn't afford what I had, so I came up with a poker game instead. But George and I were talking over dinner, and we thought that it would be really great if it's, you know, crisis moment, bridge is in flames, half the crew is dead, Picard is, you know, stalwartly in the captain's chair fighting off some terrible enemy, and suddenly you hear the hail, you know, signal, and you hear a voice saying, "Lieutenant Picard, report to the bridge." And then he touches a panel, and it all fades, and he's on the holodeck, and he steps out of the door as William Shatner, as Kirk, is walking past, and he goes, "Lieutenant, you spent a lot of time in there."
Okay. Yeah, they didn't do that.
Yeah. That almost sounds like the ending of Saint Elsewhere.
Similar vibe, yeah. No, that's very funny. You probably won't be. I'm sorry.
George was on Beauty and the Beast at the same time, and his offices were just down the street from Paramount. So George had me in his office sometimes at night, you know, close to tears, because the show was that tough. So he knew kind of the things, and you know, we liked original Trek. We grew up on Trek, and we're both science fiction guys. So, you know, we just, so that was our fantasy ending of Next Generation.
There you go. Well, you probably won't be surprised that Q played a big part, and you may or may not know that there were many, many, many poker games in the last several seasons. That was something they went back to many times.
Yep.
I think we've kind of talked the Trek part pretty well now, so let's move into other aspects of what you've been up to. I'm going to get back on script here. One of the, you know, social media can be good and social media can be bad, and there, you know, you can argue about is Facebook a good thing or not, but being able to, for someone like me, to be in touch with one of their writing heroes is just an amazing thing that eventually led to this sort of situation. So obviously I find a lot of really good things about Facebook. You posted something recently on your wall about, I'll just read it. Women are told all their lives about things they cannot do. You've also spoken with passion of the support and love your father gave you. During your life, you were trained in music, received a law degree, learned how to write, and learned how to ride horses. What were some things that you were discouraged from doing, either from society or individually, and did you go on and do some of them anyway?
I never did get to do. I remember my childhood as being, you know, a series of, what do you want to be when you grow up, little girl? And the first thing I said was, I want to be a jockey. And this was before there were women jockeys. And then I would get the condescending smile, and, oh, girls can't be jockeys.
Mm-hmm.
And then later, I desperately wanted to be an astronaut. Desperately, because, you know, that was, I'm such a science fiction person.
Right.
And, of course, girls can't be astronauts. And then the last time I was asked, I was 13 or 14, I was asked, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I said, President of the United States.
Mm.
And they literally said to me, well, don't you mean First Lady?
Oh.
And I said, no, I want to be President of the United States. And, of course, I was told that that was just silly. So, no, I have not, in fact, gotten to do some of the things I wanted to do. But what I did find is that, you know, I had a father who was enormously proud of me and enormously supportive and gave me any opportunities that society didn't block me in. I was one of the first large wave of women entering law school, and that was a difference. And the very first law firm I worked in, I mean, literally I heard men in the outer office saying, hey, I hear Charlie's hired himself a girl. Where's the girl? And then they all ran back and stared at me as I sat in my office.
Wow.
So I made monkey noises, and, you know, like I was a little monkey in a zoo.
Wow.
Which made them ashamed.
Right.
And they left. They went slinking away. And I remember one of the young associates, we were working late in the Lara library one night at my office, and he turns to me and he said, I could use a cup of coffee.
Wow.
So could I. I take it with a lot of cream. And he just gave me this look because he expected that I would get up and go get his coffee. So, yeah, I mean, sexism is real. It is much better, especially with younger generation. You know, the kids, they don't see color the way the older folks do. And there are a lot of men who've now had women bosses. And so they don't think it's unusual. But, you know, it was certainly an issue, you know, for me growing up, and has made me hyper aware. And in my other life, when I'm not being an artist, a creator, I manage a natural gas and oil company, a small one that my father founded in 1968. And I want to tell you, those good old boys in the oil patch from Texas, they are so sexist. And it's great fun to face them down, because they're just not used to it. They're just, you know, not used to women in that industry, and they're not used to women who don't back down.
Wow.
So that's kind of fun.
You still do that? Is that what you still do that? You're still managing that?
Yes, that's why I had to drive to Farmington.
I see. Okay. I was under the impression that that was one of the things you did for a period of time, and I didn't know that was still an ongoing thing. So how long have you been in that position?
I took it over to manage it in 2003.
Okay.
The gentleman who had been managing had become very elderly and was not able to handle it any longer, and he had designated me as his successor. Because he said, oh, you're your father's daughter, and I think it's so lovely that you... I mean, that was actually one of the eerie things about this trip, is we're digitizing all of these 50 years of records from... going back through some of the earlier notices, I saw these letters signed by my father, saw his handwriting, his very neat printing on the ledgers. You know, it was a little bit of a moment of remembering him in a really visceral way, mm-hmm. to see all that. So, but yeah, that's an ongoing thing. I'll continue to do it until hopefully this other thing that I can't announce yet becomes so busy that I don't have time, and then I'll probably turn it over to somebody else. But for right now, I enjoy it. I like technology, and I find working with the petroleum engineers and all that is really interesting work. So.
Let's see. Tell me a little bit more about, I know that there are some things you're involved with to some extent. You had vocal lessons, at an early age with your father's support, and you say you ride now. I know you obviously have never been a jockey, but you've been able to kind of keep both of those things, in your life to this day. Is that true?
Singing, I'm afraid, has fallen onto the wayside, sadly. My father was a fabulous musician. He played five instruments and sang, and I inherited his voice. And so I started voice lessons when I was 16 with one of his old jazz compatriots, but I didn't have a jazz voice. I have a classical voice. I was a coloratura soprano. And the teacher wisely said to my dad, I can't teach her. She's a classical voice. So then I went off and started studying opera, and then my coach sent me off to her teacher in Vienna, Austria, to attend the Conservatory de Stadt Wien, the Conservatory of Vienna, and I studied opera there for about a year and a half, and I realized that I really had a good voice, but I didn't have a world-class voice. And my accompanist, who would accompany me when I practiced, said to me, you have a brain, go back to the United States and finish your education and sing for fun. Uh-huh. So I did. I came back to the U.S. I finished getting my degree in history, and then I went on to law school, because that had been one of my dreams of my father, that I do that. And I kept singing all the way through. It was Trek that actually killed my formal singing. The hours on that show were just brutal, you know, 14, 16-hour days.
Right.
Because I had intended to find a vocal coach in California and continue singing and studying, but there was no time, and the distances and the traffic in L.A. made it very hard. So I still adore music, and I sing quietly for myself, but I don't perform anymore. But music is... I mean, I drove to Farmington listening to La Traviata and Daughter of the Regiment, two operas I happen to really love. So there was that. Horses I've done my entire life. I rode my first horse in Taos, New Mexico when I was 3 years old.
Wow.
And I was in love. And I had horses through my childhood. My dad had bought me a pinto pony, and I rode Western. And then when I was 10, he sent me off to a fancy summer camp where we rode English and jumped. So I learned how to ride English and jumping, and then I did that for a number of more years. And then ultimately I ended up doing dressage, which is what I ride now, because the jumping is hard on a body. You know,
sure.
You rarely hear about dressage riders getting killed. And people jumping, there's always a crash at some point in your life. I mean, you can always come off a horse, but touch wood, that hasn't happened to me. In a long, long time. So I have two beautiful horses. I have a Lusitano stallion named Vinto da Voga, who is about to do the Grand Prix, the top tests in dressage. And I have a new young Lusitano gelding who's just a baby. In fact, he turns 8 years old tomorrow. So, so he's my youngster. And that's sort of, I think it's really important for riders or people who live in their heads to get out and do something physical.
Mm-hmm.
Too many times riders are sedentary and they just sit, and it really, you think better if you're active. So I not only ride two horses 5 days a week, on the days I don't ride, I go to a gym and I work out. Because I think that's really, I think that helps you stay creative and helps you do better at work.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of truth to that. I'll be honest, that's a struggle I have now, trying to find ways to be more active with the sedentary side. I have three children who, we have a community pool, and of course it's the middle of summer now, so I have been getting out more often, and I know John can speak to his struggles with staying more active too.
Yeah, I just recently joined a gym a couple months ago, and while I have gone more times this year than I had in about 5 to 10 years prior, I'm still not regular as I should. A buddy of ours, who's a DJ and has actually helped with the production, early production of this show. He's a beast in the gym. He's there every day, you know, bench pressing 300 pounds and carrying on, and you know, on the treadmill and stuff. And if anything, he's been an inspiration to me, which is why I end up going at least maybe once or twice a week. not as much as I should, but you know, more active than I have been in the past. So it is a struggle, definitely.
Oh, listen, I hear you. It's so much easier to say, I wonder what somebody posted on Facebook.
Oh yeah.
But I do love physical activity, and I especially love it with the horses because it's the closest, especially for dressage. It's the closest thing to telepathy there is in the world. It's like you think it, and the horse reads your minute muscle signals, and it's such delicate, subtle work, and then they do these fancy steps, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I love it dearly. So it's in fact, I mean, I wanted to stay at home in New Mexico for another few days, but on the other hand, by going back to L.A. tomorrow night, I'll get to ride on Saturday. So that's good, because I haven't ridden for a week, and I hate it when I don't get to.
Very cool. I know you're best known for on television for your Trek work, at least within the circles of the fan community. Did you do some things on other shows that you're particularly proud of that you can maybe mention
I wrote for a show called Reasonable Doubts with Mark Harmon and Marley Maitland. It was a great show, and I wrote some scripts for that show that I'm very proud of. One of them, my boss chose to represent us at the Emmys for the nominating, not as a, you know, we weren't up for an award, but the thing they send in to see if you get on the ballot. He picked a script of mine that I had written and he directed. And then I was on Profiler, and we did some interesting work on that show. It was about serial FBI team hunting serial killers. I mean, the irony is my work in television, I've been on more shows that aren't science fiction than are. And I've been on a cop lawyer show and a cop show, and then Star Trek. And I've written a lot of TV pilots. I've written some feature films that never got made. In terms of just the amount of work I've done, most of it has been non-genre. It's been more in the cop genre, cop lawyer genre. So, you know, interesting. And then, of course, you know, I'm still a novelist. So that part of my life still goes on.
Maybe we should take that as a segue. I know you have at least three series, by which I mean you have two that are ongoing and one that is brand new and just coming out. So You want to just go through those real quick and give a pitch for each?
I have a series of books called the Edge series, which is about the war between science and rationality and superstition and religion. There are three books out in that series, The Edge of Reason, The Edge of Ruin, and The Edge of Dawn. And I would love to write a fourth one to tie it all up, because I'm a serious plotter and I know what the final scene of the final book is, and I need one more book to get to that scene. So I've got to get into it with Tor Books or with Titan, who publishes the English editions of those books, and see if I get to do that fourth book, which would be called The Edge of Infinity. If I get to write it. And then I do my new series is called Imperials, and book one just came out on the 5th, came out on Tuesday. It's called The High Ground, and it's a space opera. It's a swashbuckling space opera with, you know, a princess and the tailor's son, and aliens as subjected people in a very hierarchical society. Book two has been delivered, and I'm working on book three, so I'm busy.
Good.
And then the other thing I had been doing was I wrote a series, an urban fantasy series under a pseudonym, which was Philippa Bornikova. And I got two of them are out. They're called This Case Is Gonna Kill Me and Box Office Poison. And the third book I delivered, and then there was a series of hiccups with my editor and various things with my publisher. And it hasn't been published yet. They haven't gotten back to me with notes, so it's kind of sitting on the back burner. That was fun. It was a series set with a young woman lawyer in a vampire law firm in New York. She's not a vampire, but she works for a bunch of vampires in New York. I was sort of literalizing the metaphor.
Right.
And the second book takes place in Hollywood, and it draws on a lot of my experiences on sets and things that some of the events in it were things that have actually, you know, I've seen or have happened to me. So it was fun to get to write about combined sort of went together the law and the Hollywood career into a book. You know, the books did pretty well, but I think they're still available, and they're certainly available electronically, but, you know, they were fun. They're much lighter. My other books are more serious, delve into more serious issues. And then last but not least, there's Wild Cards.
Oh, yeah.
It's a shared world anthology that George Martin and I created together many years ago, and that George and I edit together, and I still write for it. George hasn't had time to write for it because he's got this other thing he has to do. but for the longest time, you know, he and I were writing stories, and then we would just invite other writers in to write and play in our sandbox, and it is so much fun to work with. We have a great, great roster of writers. I mean, we've got Paul Cornell, who used to write for Doctor Who. We've got Max Gladstone, this up-and-coming young writer. Roger Zelazny, the great Roger Zelazny, was one of our Wild
Yes,
writers.
Yes. Yes, I loved him. Yes, I was a big fan of his series.
The Amber books.
Yeah.
Yeah, I miss Roger every day. He was such a dear friend, and he gave us so much joy with what he created. So that's Wild Cards, and book number 23 will be published in August. And George and I are reading the stories for the next three books, which are going to be coming out in the next couple of years. Low Chicago, Mississippi Roll, and Texas Hold'em.
Wow. Now, I remember seeing those. When did that start? Back in the late 80s?
Book one, Wild Cards, came out in 1987, I believe.
Yeah.
86 or 87.
I remember seeing them on the shelf. Was there a gap between two sets for a while, or...?
We had a big hiatus, and then Tor, we were at Bantam, and then we went to Maine, and then there was a big hiatus, and then we were picked up by a small publisher, and then that went away, and then Tor Books picked us back up, and they're reissuing all the early books with these spectacular Michael Komar covers, and we've got three graphic novels in the works. I've done one, Carrie Vaughn has done one, and Kevin Murphy and John Miller have done another. My artist is brilliant, but he's slow. I am Komar doing my... Oh, shoot, I'm sorry, let me turn this off. So, Sorry, I forgot to turn off my phone. Forgive me.
That's quite
and
all right.
I see my New York agent, but I will call her back.
Yikes! Do we need to pause?
No, it's okay. I'll call her back.
Okay. All right.
I'll call her back when I'm done.
Wow, we rate over her agent, John.
Wow, that's
sorry, that was rude. I thought I had shut it down. Anyway, where were we? Talking about wild cards. So we have a lot going on with wild cards. There are games. There, Green Ronin has a game book out for it. And I love wild cards. It's great fun.
And you've known George Martin for a very, very long time. And tell me what it's like working, having someone you call a friend who's paid their dues all these years, and now here he is.
He's a societal meme.
Yeah.
it's been great fun to watch it happen, and I'm so happy for him and pleased for him because he worked very hard for a very long time. He's a wonderful writer. He's a wonderful human being. And, you know, it's nice to see one of the good guys get a big win. You know, I'm really, really pleased for it. You know, I have the advantage that he'll always just be George to me. And so, you know, there's no, you know, because the first time I met Roger Zelazny, I was so overcome I could barely speak. I was just breathless. And I'm sure that's how people feel when they meet George and don't know him. And right. I can just sit back and sort of watch and smile and go, really, he doesn't bite. You know, he's such a great guy. And you know, we've had a lot of fun together. I mean, Wild Cards grew out of our role-playing group. We were all in a role-playing game group.
That's mind-blowing. Just the idea that you were in a role-playing group with George R. R. Martin and some other folks, obviously you couldn't have known that one of them would go on and kind of get that pop culture status, but that's just wild as a fan on the outside hearing that.
Walter John Williams, George, Daniel Abraham, me, you know.
Wow.
I know, it's like the weirdest role-playing group. A lot of us have done a lot of done theater, so it became like improv theater. There were nights when we would hardly roll a dice, you know, we would just play.
Role-playing can be like that. I've had those nights.
Our gods, our game masters were fantastic. We had Walter as a game master, we had Vic Milan as a game master, we had George Martin as a game master, you know.
To have a time machine and go back and just be able to see that would be so wild. You have posted about another acquaintance that John and I have been fans of for a long time. Go ahead, John.
Yeah, I'd like to take this one. So just recently at the Indiana Comic Con, I had the distinct honor and pleasure of meeting Mr. Marv Wolfman, the comic book legend. As a writer, he's someone who helped to influence me because a lot of my own writing is comic book inspired. I hear that you and Mr. Wolfman are friends. Would you care to elaborate and let us know what that's like?
Oh, yeah. Marv is great. I don't get to see as much of Marv and Noelle as I used to because she works for Blizzard and they've moved down, you know, down in Irvine or Orange County or wherever Blizzard is located. And so I only run into them occasionally, which is a real shame because I love them both. They're just great people. Marv is one of the greats. He, together with my other friend, Lynn Ween.
Yes.
Wow. Now you've got my fanboy heart gushing. It's like pounding in my chest. Okay, so I'm my ears perked up, and I guess you know I'm kind of smiling. If you can kind of hear that in my voice.
I know Lynn very well. In fact, I see them almost every weekend. They do a sort of potluck supper on Sunday nights most weekends. And I see them all the time, Lynn and his wife Christine, Lynn is wonderful. What can I say? And I understand he's having a huge success with this new Swamp Thing that he's doing. So you know, I'm very pleased for him. I mean, between Marv and Lynn, you know, they have so much foundation in what is, you know, modern comics, really. And of course, so many of their characters have ended up on the screen.
Yep.
Yeah. You know?
I'm one of the. There was a period of time where they Marvel was experimenting with paperback books, and I managed to get a hold of, I think, the only Amazing Spider-Man one they did in the 70s, and it was written by the both of them, Len Wein and Marv Wolfman. They co-wrote it together. It was very good.
Len and Marv go way back. I think they've been buddies since they were teenagers in New York.
And so do they live in New Mexico? Or?
No, they live in California.
Oh, okay.
Len is in L.A., well, Northridge, a little east and north of, you know, one of the suburbs of L.A. And Marv was in Tarzana, but then they moved south. But like I said, it's harder to see people when, you know, the distances and the traffic make it tough. So I only see Marv occasionally, but Len, like I said, I see virtually every week.
Well, you know, just you mentioning that, and I mean, I had to... take a deep breath here. So, Mr. Len Wein, he created one of my favorite characters, which is Wolverine.
Yeah.
And such an iconic character at that. And it's amazing the less than 6 degrees of separation that social media, the digital world we live in, gets me in contact with someone who is a writer and creator of one of my favorite comic book characters from the time that I was a kid is just amazing. I never even dreamed of that, so this is really awesome.
Occasionally Facebook can be horrific when you have crazy racists and horrible people saying terrible things on it, but it can also be very rewarding. I really enjoy Facebook and the people I've gotten to meet and gotten to know, and I think it can, well, like anything, it can be good and bad. You know, it's whether people choose to be good or bad is the issue. But no, Lynn, if you get a chance, if he's at a Comic-Con near you sometime, he is so friendly, so approachable. He is such a lovely guy. You will really, I mean, he'll just sit and chat with you if he's not too busy and just talk about, you know, creating and writing. He's lovely. So,
you actually,
I hope you have that opportunity.
I do too.
You actually, and I was trying to figure out how to segue, and you guys created it for me. I wanted to wrap up by talking about the social media experience. The fact of the matter is, I had kind of lost track of your career and where you were there for a number of years, and then found David Gerald, and then I think he tagged you in something, and I went, oh wow, she's on here. So do you have a lot of folks who were fans come and find you? Because when I went looking for you, I did what I normally do, which is go look for a Facebook business page, and you didn't have one, and I thought, well, surely she's not just going to let me follow her personal page, and I sent you a short note, and I was very pleased to find that you were okay with that. So does that happen to you often?
Yeah, it does, actually. You know, and it's one of the ways that I can, when I get these friend requests, thank God our tribe is very clear. Like, if I see something with the Enterprise on it or a comic book, I'll go, oh, okay, this is one of my tribe. I can, I can say okay and confirm this person to be a friend. I don't have such a huge following that I have to go to a professional page. And I like the fact that I can interact with people and actually talk directly to them. I like to teach at cons. I really enjoy doing workshops or coffee classes or things where I can actually one-on-one interact with people. I mean, writing is such, it's a career in which people really do pay it forward, and they're very welcoming to newcomers and very helpful. I mean, my friend Victor Milan helped me segue from being a lawyer to being a writer of books. George Martin gave me the hand up to help me get into Hollywood. When I was writing this graphic novel for Wild Cards, I would go to Lynn with any questions I had, because why not go and ask the best?
Well, sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
A comic book script and run questions I had past him. And there is this generosity. So, you know, at some point, if this thing I can't announce yet, you know, comes to fruition and goes forward and becomes a big hit and things change, then maybe I will be forced to, you know, go to that separation of having the professional business page and not be able to interact as often as I do. But, you know, that's for the future. And right now it works out. I have good people. Everybody behaves.
Yes.
Very courteous. Because by and large, are science fiction people are good folks.
And you know, on that topic, because you did allow me to follow you, and you know, I watched your posts for a while before we started having dialogues and stuff, and it was so awesome how you were welcoming to those questions and would push further with that. And then you posted something that was very heartbreaking to me, that to hear your specific story and the sort of thing that it seems like it happens to women much more often than men, because I've never had this sort of experience where there are these predatory men out there who just will friend somebody and then immediately start sending explicit posts and other things and bunch of craziness, which ruins it for everybody, especially in a situation like this where you hope that someone's going to be open to you, and then they have an experience like that, and it just makes you hope that they're not going to shut things down for everybody and ruin it for the whole group.
Yeah, no, I mean, you know, I'm getting to where, like, if they're wearing a military uniform or a tuxedo or leaning against a really fancy car, I know they're fake.
Right.
I just feel them immediately.
Yeah, there is that.
I mean, fortunately, you know, it didn't upset me. I thought it was kind of funny, and if I had, I'm not a blushing, you know, flower, and I've done theater, so I've changed clothes backstage in front of stagehands more time than I care to remember. So it didn't particularly, you know, it didn't upset me. I thought it was sort of funny, but I could see where for a woman with maybe a different personality or different background, that could be really shocking and horrifying. But again, you know, I think sometimes in life, nobody promises that it's going to be easy, and nobody promises that there won't be things that happen that upset you. You know, you just have to learn how to handle things and go on, you know, move forward. If I'd been thinking a little more instead of just, you know, erasing the post and blocking the guy, I should have written back and given him a detailed critique. That's usually the better way to handle those things, because then they never come around again.
Sure,
right.
And they may be hesitant to do it to any other woman.
Right.
But yeah, you know, it's. I would say overall, you know, is the internet evil or is it a good thing? I think on balance, it's probably a little more of a good thing than a bad thing. I mean, for one thing, I mean, I'm trying to decide if I'm going to write a post about this anti-Semitic wave that is sweeping the country. And because I have, you know, so many friends who, for whom this is very visceral and very real. And you know, it's horrifying to see these people, whether it's against blacks or Jews or gays or women or whoever it is, saying these things. On the other hand, I'm glad they're exposing themselves.
Right.
Let the world see their ugly faces.
Well, when I first got here, John was talking about that he's feeling a bit down today because that all over the internet people are discussing in various ways that terrible shooting that just happened.
It's unbelievable. I mean, it's like, how many times does this have to happen before the country wakes up and says, this is not acceptable, and we've got a problem with policing in this country? And you know, I'm not slamming police. I have a dear friend who is a retired detective, and there are good cops and there are bad cops, but this is just, it's unconscionable what is happening to African-Americans. I mean, my specialty in law school was constitutional law. So I feel, you know, we are demeaning this great document. With every time something like this happens, we are violating the promise and not coming to grips with our original sin as a nation. Sorry, I don't mean to get all heavy on you.
I appreciate the earnestness of what you're saying, and I, for one, outside of being a writer of speculative fiction, if anyone's ever looked at my Facebook page or looked at my tweets or whatever, they know that I'm a person who is a staunch and vocal champion against racism, against discrimination, against anyone who discriminates against anyone for any reason, you know, whether it be race, religion, you know, sexual orientation, what have you, you know, because that to me is just hate, and I don't believe in hate. You know, you can dislike someone for whatever reason, but, you know, I've experienced on both sides hate, and I know how hurtful it is and how consuming it is, not, you know, just to people it may be focused at, but to the person who's actually giving it. And so I'm a very vocal champion for equal rights for everyone, and to not to find a point champion against racism. So I'm glad that I'm not alone in this, and I hope that, like your friend, a lot of the good cops speak up against the bad cops and are vocal about that, because that's what we're going to need to change things and to make sure that these things are addressed in the open so that people can see who's who, what's what, and get something going.
Yeah, no, I mean, I always hesitate because I'm a privileged white woman, you know. I my dad was a successful businessman, and, you know, I don't want to, I can't speak to it. I mean, yeah, I have had issues of sexism, but, you know, I think the racial issues in this country are just, I don't recognize my country right now, guys, when there are people attacking Muslim Americans and African Americans, Jewish Americans,
gay Americans.
I had really thought things were better. I thought we were reaching to sort of bring us back full circle. I thought we were starting to reach toward that Star Trek universe, the good part of the Star Trek universe, the thing that made us all love that show. The idea of the United Federation of Planets, or I'll just say United Earth at this point.
You know? Yeah, exactly.
Right.
And to see what's happening right now, you know, to this country is terrifying.
I absolutely agree.
Come through it and not, and haven't damaged ourselves on a real fundamental psychic level here.
And I think that brings it back around to social media, which I think, for better or for worse, it seems to be a reflection of where our society is, and it can be a scary thing. And that's, you know, I don't think a day goes by where I don't cringe at something I scroll through, you know, where it's just like, really? Where's that coming from? Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's up to people like the three of us to make sure that our sites are upbeat and encouraging and welcoming, and, you know, maybe we shed a little light in the darker corners of the interwebs, you know?
Absolutely. What a great segue. Actually, do you have anything more, John?
No, I would just like to take the time to personally thank you for granting us this interview and giving us such a earnest and heartfelt discussion. I really appreciate that. You don't get a lot of that these days, and when you do, you cherish those moments. So thank you so much for that.
Well, thank you guys so much for having me. I really enjoyed it.
So let's talk about where people can find you.
On Facebook. And I have a website, melindasnodgrass.com. Yep. I do tweet, but rarely and poorly.
Yeah, same.
M is in Melinda, M is in Marilyn Snodgrass on Twitter. And those are the primary places to find me.
All right. And if you have any past interest in Trek or are interested in finding out what she's doing nowadays, reach out to her. She's very open to that, and she loves having these discussions. And it's been a pleasure to get to discover you again and get to know you again these last couple of years. I've enjoyed our interactions immensely. Obviously, of the two of us, I'm the big fan. I'm the one that came with all the questions today. There'll be another episode where I'm sure I'll be sitting and letting John kind of fanboy out. But this was my turn today, and I greatly appreciate you accepting our offer, and it's been a pleasure for me.
Well, just to let everyone know, I am a Star Trek fan, and I, you know, I didn't have a lot of questions, but the questions that I asked and the way in which they were answered were just make my heart go pitter-patter. So there you go.
And this will not be the last you'll be hearing of Melinda. We're going to be doing a Star Trek Beyond movie review here in a few weeks.
Yes.
And Melinda has graciously agreed to come in as an honorary third tower.
That's right.
I can believe a 5'1" tower.
Yeah, a very small tower.
So that'll be that'll be a lot of fun. I'm looking forward to that.
Me too. Thanks, guys.
All right. Well, that just wraps up another episode of the Two Towers Talk Show. I want to thank everyone who tuned in to join us. And again, I want to thank our special guest, Melinda Snodgrass, for joining us for this episode. So until next time, hey-wa!
The Two Towers Talk Show is sponsored in part by Showtime Cinema in Mooresville, Indiana. Their friendly staff is always willing to go the extra mile to make your movie-going experience an enjoyable and memorable one. Enjoy the comfort of their new cushioned seating in their spacious auditoriums, and while you're there, be sure to stop by the concession stand and purchase some popcorn, where real butter topping is an option. They're located at 300 South Bridge Street in Mooresville, Indiana. We hope to see you at the movies! Be sure to check out our advertising partner, DC and Marvel, a Universal Alliance. They are a friendly Facebook community who offer digital comic book giveaways, games, tournaments, and viewing parties. Follow the link below and give them a look. You'll be glad you did.